itself is surrounded by a plethora of urban myths, all helping to build the legend and to feed the hype first. The Air Jordan 1 is said to be based on the Giorgio Armani-designed Nike Chicago. Second, and more importantly, the shoe was initially banned by the National Basketball Association, NBA. Michael Jordan wore the black and red model because it matched the colours of the Chicago Bulls basketball team. However, the shoe broke league colour rules, which stated that all shoes had to have a white sole base. Marketing conscious Nike jumped on the free publicity generated and created more hype with its banned by the NBA commercials, taking the model to the top of the sales charts. After being fined, Jordan mostly wore the white, black, red model instead, and it was in these that he amassed the infamous 63-point score against the Boston Celtics. The Air Jordan 1 is the only model of the series to feature the Nike swoosh logo. It is also the model released in the greatest number of colorways, 23, to match Jordan's shirt number. The shoes were sold with a double set of laces to match the two different colours, and they are probably the most collectible of all trainers in terms of value. Next up. Still stand gazing back on the good old days, or do we take our chances and look to the future? When Nike introduced the Air Max 1 in 1987, it certainly was looking to the future. In fact, these shoes were the future. This was the first shoe that aimed to reveal rather than conceal sole technology. The Air Max 1 was the latest offering in the technological development of the Air system. The system of pressurized gas encapsulated in polyurethane was developed by Marion Frank Rudin, an independent inventor from California. shoes brings to mind as another of the cultural entrants into the Hall of Fame. No list of trainers would be complete without it. The classic, to use its common name, is the biggest selling single model of trainer in the UK today. It is seen everywhere, every day, and on every street corner. Strangely, the shoe seems to have no cultural boundaries and easily crosses over the different genres of inner city youth culture and is seen most often in its purest white blink blink form. Just a disclaimer, I'm not too sure when this book was made, but Reebok Classic being the best selling trainer in the UK might not be correct anymore, but don't quote me on that, I'm not 100%. So, among the older generation also cannot be underestimated, and due to the comfort factor, the Classic is also popular with supermarket visiting mothers. Even though the initial beginnings of this shoe are clouded in urban folklore, this particular piece of folklore happens to be true. When Reebok was developing the model for production, there was a misorder at the factory, which resulted in the delivery of some hyper-supple kangaroo leather. With time at a premium, the shoes were made up using the now famous kangaroo hide, and a Classic shoe came into being. It was the very nature of this mistake that gave rise to the shoe's popularity. Love it or hate it, there is no denying that this trainer is incredibly comfortable to wear, and the particular look and feel that came about as a result has given it a unique aesthetic. However, for a shoe that is so universally popular, it sure takes a lot of stick, curiously. Even though it is so popular, and even though Reebok is the only British brand to be part of the Big Few, it is Adidas that has brand loyalty among the British trainer purists, with Reebok receiving more respect across the pond in the United States. Okay, last one for this week is the Adidas Ultrastar. Understand it if a few people start scratching their heads when they see the Ultrastar including in there, as it is generally known to be a reworking of the iconic Adidas Superstar. However, dig a little deeper and, for more than one reason, it becomes obvious it is more than at home in such illustrious company. Let me tell you why. First is the cultural reason. This shoe has been chosen to represent hip-hop, one of the two most important cultural movements associated with trainers, the other being football or soccer. The most important part of any b-boy's or breakboy's wardrobe was his trainers. Two other current members of this Hall of Fame, the Puma Suede and the Adidas Superstar, could have been chosen to represent this trainer tribe, but the Ultrastar sneaks it for another important reason. The shoe represents the moment when the trainer brands finally woke up to the fact that trainers weren't only being used for sport. It was the devotion of the hip-hop heads, and in particular leading rap group Run DMC, that led to this revelation. DMC were by no means the first to embrace sneaker culture, but in response to an anti-trainer rap song called Felon Sneakers, they were the first to really openly declare their love when they released their single called My Adidas. And it was this that finally brought the hip-hop movement to the attention of the company. It seems amazing now, but back then, the question of whether hardcore rappers were an inappropriate group for Adidas endorsees almost split the old company. But in one simple act, Run DMC made up a mind. song about